If you can hear me, you can hear me as well as lip read. So anyway, welcome to St. John's Church, Buckhurst Hill, this Sunday morning. And we trust that you will enjoy worshipping God together with us here. It would be wonderful if we could all be gathered in the church. We can't do that at the moment. So wherever you are, we welcome you. We pray that you would have listening ears, warm hearts, and a good voice. Sing wherever you may be. But let me begin with an opening prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love for us wherever we are. Thank you that each one of us is important to you. Thank you for the love you have for us and all the world. We pray that you would accept our praises, hear our prayers, speak to us in your word, and bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to say just a few responses before an opening time of wonderful praise together, if you would join in the words in yellow. We live by faith and not by sight. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the things which are seen are temporal. Hallelujah. Amen.
Jerusalem.
Jesus is our hope. Not just our individual hope, but hope for all the nations. But for every individual, the place of that hope is the forgiveness we receive in Christ, who died for us. We take a moment to be quiet and then join in some confessional responses. Then we'll continue in prayer and then close with the Lord's Prayer together. Lord, we have come to see that our lives fall far short of your glory. Have mercy on us, Lord, and forgive us. Lord, you have given your life for us and poured out your Spirit. Yet we fail to return your love with all our heart. Have mercy on us, Lord, and change us. Too often we are selfish and proud, ignoring you, Lord, and neglecting others. Have mercy on us, Lord, and cleanse us. Amen. Loving Heavenly Father, we want to pray this morning in particular for those who may be neglected. In our locality and in our nation and in our world. We pray, Father, for each and every person who may be on their own, for whatever circumstance of life, for widows and widowers, for those who are single but not by their choice, for orphans with no family to care for them, for the lonely, Father, for the lonely in heart, who may be quietly enduring day after day. We pray for a gracious touch of your Holy Spirit. We pray for good neighbours. We pray for friendships. We pray for compassion and care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father, we pray for those whose neglect may lead to great suffering. We pray for any who are trapped in flats and homes with an abusive partner. We pray for the danger that they are in, for the isolation and fear. And Father, we pray for rescue. We pray for people to help. We pray for some way out. And we're conscious that in the times that we are in, such people may be deeply neglected and fearful. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And loving Heavenly Father, we pray for the poor who may simply be neglected by the lack of facilities and provision where they live. We are conscious in our own community that there may be people who are lonely, and there may be people on their own, and there may be people who are struggling financially. But we're also conscious that there are many parts of the world where there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people who may, in these particular times, be suffering acutely because they depended on a daily wage and there is no daily wage. And without a daily wage, there is no food. and without food they starve. Loving Heavenly Father, we know that you are sovereign over all and the world lies in your hands. We pray that we might understand what you are doing in your world today. We pray, as you instruct us to, for those in positions of leadership in governments of the nations, that they may not just have a concern for their own patch, but a concern to help those in need, wherever they may be found. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We join in saying the words of the Lord's Prayer. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We're going to join in a creedal song of praise, affirming our beliefs together. Thank you. Shall we pray together? Loving Heavenly Father, we believe that through your Son and the gift of your Spirit, you are here now. You are here not just in this church building, but you can be in every home where anyone is joining in this morning. And you are present for a purpose, to forgive us, to heal us, to cleanse us, to renew us, to equip us, and to send us out as your disciples. Give us, we pray, hearts and minds open to your word, that we may be guided in the paths you wish us to walk in. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We've been looking in Sunday mornings at the resurrection appearances of Jesus. And he appeared first of all to Mary Magdalene, then to a small group of women as they were walking along the path. And then to Peter at some time, and then to two men walking along a road to a village outside Jerusalem. Then he appeared to the disciples in a room, and then a week later to the disciples again in the same room. Then a little time after that, he appeared to them by the lake side in Galilee. He appeared to 500 people all at once, and last time we were thinking about his appearance to his own brother, James. And I guess if you're human, you might be thinking, well, I wish he'd appear to me. If only Jesus would turn up, then of course I would be a Christian. I would be a disciple, I would be a believer, and give my life to him. It's unfair. He appeared to all them then, what about now? So we're going to read from John chapter 20, the first 9 verses. Same day, but Jesus hasn't yet appeared to anybody. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, there in Jerusalem, and said to them, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb. We do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going towards the tomb. Both of them were running together. But the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there. But he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I'm sure that some of the time when we read the Bible stories, we're meant to smile or laugh even. I mean, have you thought about Jews of the first century running? I mean, the Olympic Games were going on in Jesus' time, but they competed without anything on their feet, or indeed without any clothes on their body. And to the Jews, nakedness was a shameful thing. So it's not clear whether they participated in the Olympic Games or not. And here we are on this first morning. And we're going to think this morning about that first morning. And we're going to think about how does faith start? And then secondly, how is faith made secure? If you like, you know, your letters, that's two S's. How does faith start? And how is faith made secure? So here's Mary. Mary's walking along to the tomb. It's still dark. She's arranged to meet some other women there, and they're carrying wet spices. They are going to anoint the dead body of Jesus because they hadn't had time after he died and was put in the tomb. There were some dry spices around Jesus that had been put there by the men, Nicodemus and Joseph. But this is the women coming after the Sabbath to anoint his body. So they're getting there as soon as they can. And as they approach the tomb, they see that the stone has been rolled away. Mary immediately turns and runs back into the city of Jerusalem. Now, I don't know if you've watched any films of first century Jerusalem or Roman Empire stuff, but she wasn't wearing the latest athletics kit. Though she must have hitched up her skirt in some way or the other and scuttled back into the city, past lots of people, because it's festival time and the whole nation is gathered together. You cannot get the whole people of Israel into the city of Jerusalem at festival time. Outside the walls of Jerusalem, there are thousands of tents. And indeed, Jesus' own family would have normally been in some kind of tent outside the city of Jerusalem when they came to the festivals. And so here they are. They're not, of course, going to be camped at a cemetery. So there'll be a space of some sort. But nevertheless, Mary is scuttling back through the gate, through the streets of the city to find Peter and John. Peter and John then also run. Indeed, they run together and they have a race. Have you tried running in sandals? There's your test this summer. Try running in sandals. Not that easy. They too, of course, are wearing robes. So they too have got to hitch them up. And there they go. And we have this astonishing detail about this race. John is faster than Peter. He arrives at the tomb first. We need to register that the tomb is not like a church yard grave area. It's more like a small cave. There'll be the big stone that was rolled away from the entrance. Inside, if you've had the opportunity to go to any catacombs anywhere, there would have been niches in the rock or the cave walls where bodies would have been laid. We know that this is a brand new tomb belonging to the rich man Joseph of Arimathea, and Jesus is the only body inside when they rolled the stone in front. So John arrives, the stone has been rolled away, he bends down and looks inside the tomb. He sees some linen cloths, he does not go in. Peter, of course, bold and brash, comes running up behind. Incidentally, this is the only verse where we can ascertain the supposed conclusion that John is younger than Peter. We assume that John is younger than Peter because he got there first. I don't know why we should make that kind of assumption, but that's the assumption we make. Partly also, of course, because John keeps living until the 90s. Peter comes running up behind. He doesn't stop. He bursts into the tomb. He sees there's nobody there. and the linen cloths, and the face cloth that was on Jesus's face rolled up neatly by itself. Then John goes in, and this is what we read. In verse 9, or 8, in verse 8 of the chapter. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. No appearance of Jesus. Jesus has not yet appeared to anybody at all. And John, who is called the beloved disciple, whom Jesus has a kind of special relationship with, is not recorded as ever having a personal appearance of Jesus. And yet here we read, he goes into the tomb, he sees a napkin neatly folded up by itself, and we read, he saw and believed. Astonishing. It is astonishing what starts off anybody's faith. A neat piece of grave clothing. That was it. Nothing else. How is it for you? The stories people say about how they start their Christian life are truly amazing. Here are three or four that have been said to me, and since we're in St. John's Church, Buckhurst Hill, and the church family may be listening, I'm very quickly going to say that none of these people are members of this church, just in case you want to walk around and say, you? No, surely not. That wasn't you, was it? Somebody came to me, a lady who shared her testimony, and her Christian faith started because somebody shook her hand. I mean, what can you make of that? Told me. Her Christian journey started because somebody shook her hand, and she felt such a warmth in the handshake that she wanted to know more about this person. I mean, that is just nonsense, really, isn't it? Here's another one. A gentleman walking past a church looks through the window and sees a little girl riding a bike. This gentleman, who's never been inside the church, says to himself as he carries on walking, I've just walked past a church and there was a little girl riding a bicycle. I don't understand that. So we went home, and the next Sunday, this gentleman, who was a working kind of man who didn't normally wear a shirt and tie, ironed his one white shirt, put it on, and walked into the church. His Christian life began looking through the window of a church. Here's another guy walking along the road. And he sees some people walking down the other side of the road, smartly dressed, carrying Bibles. What are they doing? Well, they're going to church. Well, I should be going to church. Just saw somebody on the street. Amazing. Here's a young man looking forward to his wedding day. Never goes to church at all, but wants to get married in the church. So they have the service in the church. They've had the whole service and everything and all that. It's the last bit of the service, and he is kneeling down with his wife that he's just got married to, and the priest lays his hands on him and blesses him. He feels something in his body. somewhat unusually for people in that situation, he came back to the church the next Sunday. And after that, and after that, and after that. Brothers and sisters and friends, the way that faith starts is weird. Just weird. And it's personal. And why don't you all tell one another how it happened for you? Because the stories are simply amazing. Imagine John's testimony in Ephesus, where he eventually lives. You know, I was running with Peter, and I outran him. I was faster than him. I hitched up my robe and I ran to the tomb, and he went past me first, and then I went in, and there was a cloth, the face cloth, lying by itself. And I saw it, and I believed. So faith starts from almost anything that you could possibly imagine. But it's not made secure by anything you can possibly imagine. It's made secure by one very clear thing. And we might just need to remind ourselves what we've been looking at over these last few weeks, the resurrection appearances of Jesus. There's 11 of them. 5 of them occur on the very first day. And Jesus is around for another 39 days. So either the other 6 appearances are very rare, well, we know they're not because we're told when some of them happen. Well, what's he doing then for these 40 days between his resurrection and his ascension into heaven? Well, the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 1 and the first few verses, where Luke, who's writing that part of the New Testament, says that during these days, Jesus was teaching the disciples about the kingdom of God. That's what Jesus was doing. Teaching the disciples about the kingdom of God. Yet more teaching. Yet more teaching, yet more teaching. Let me tell you about the kingdom of God. Let me explain these scriptures to you. Beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained all the verses of the Bible about himself. Let me tell you about the kingdom of God. Imagine Jesus waking up. Does Jesus wake up? I mean, there's a question. Incidentally, I would just like at this point to correct last week's puzzle as to whether or not Jesus was a grandfather. Thank you for all those people who joined in. Let me categorically say to all the world, Jesus was not a grandfather. Okay? He might have been an uncle or even a great uncle, but he was not a grandfather. Thank you for joining in. Did he sleep with his resurrected body between his resurrection and his ascension? I mean, did he have to sleep? Imagine him waking up every day. I'm going to teach you yet more about the kingdom of God. I'm going to tell you about the wonderful things that lie ahead. Let me tell you. Let me begin with Moses. Let me tell you about Isaiah. Let me tell you about Samuel. Let me tell you about David. It's so exciting, the kingdom of God. That's why I'm here. I am telling you about the kingdom of God. In verse 9 of our reading, it went on to say this. For as yet, they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. How are we made secure in our faith? By understanding the scriptures. That's what Jesus was doing. That's what he did in the 3 years of his ministry. It's also what he did in the 40 days of his appearances. And although John had come to faith by looking at a piece of cloth, his faith was made secure by listening to Jesus as he explained the scriptures to him. And what was true for John is true for you and I. The New Testament tells us that there are two things that are essential for understanding the Scriptures. Because it's easy to read the Scriptures and not understand them. I mean, that even occurs in the New Testament anyway. For example, in Matthew chapter 22, some people gather around Jesus and they say, "What about this? I mean, here is a woman, she's married, her husband dies, she marries a brother, marries a brother, marries a brother, marries a brother, because all the brothers are told they must marry the widow. There are seven brothers, they all die. And then she dies. Whose husband does she have? Who's the husband in heaven?" And Jesus says what? "You do not understand the Scriptures." Or again in Acts chapter 8, where there's the treasurer of Ethiopia traveling along in his carriage, reading the Scriptures, but not understanding them. And Philip comes up alongside, sent by God, and asks the question, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And the guy says, "No, I don't." Or the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, talking about his own nation, and particularly about the Pharisees and religious leaders. They're zealous for God. They're keen. They're on fire. They're set alight. But they don't understand. We are made secure in our faith when we understand the Scriptures. And human history, ever since the Bible has been put together, is full of people who have read the Scriptures and not understood them. China, in the 19th century. Millions die because somebody reading the Scriptures believes that he is the Son of God, returned to earth. Germany, in the 1530s. Thousands and thousands and thousands of people die because somebody believes from reading the Scriptures that they are anointed by God to lead a war, which they're not. And sadly, there are people whose own individual lives are ruined because they pick up the Bible, they read some sentences, and they completely misunderstand what they read. There is, of course, the joke about the person who opens the Bible wanting to know what to do and comes across the verse, "And Judas went and hanged himself." So the person thinks, "Well, I'm not sure that that's the word for me." So they turn over a few pages and come across another verse, which says, "What you're going to do, go and do it quickly." It's easy to turn over the pages of the Bible and misunderstand them. That was the case in Jesus' day. It's been the case throughout history, and it can certainly be the case today. And we may all be aware of people who have messed up their lives. So if faith is made secure by understanding the Scriptures, what are the two things that we need? Number one, in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11, we are told, God appoints pastor teachers. God appoints pastor teachers. So that people might understand the Scriptures and become mature in faith. And not be childlike and tossed about by every kind of doctrine they may come across. Indeed, to become full with the whole fullness of Jesus. Because God appoints pastor teachers. And then secondly, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and also in verse 11 and a few verses onwards, we are told that without the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we cannot understand the scriptures. So these are the two things that are essential if our faith is to be made secure: the gift of pastor teachers and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And actually, in the next 2 weeks, we're going to look at these two things. Because, of course, if we don't have a right pastor teacher, we might be no better off. And we can quench the Holy Spirit. So there's going to be 2 follow-on sermons looking at these things, which we need to be secure in our faith. But the wonderful and exciting thing is that all of us, whoever we are, might start our Christian faith in the weirdest way imaginable. Thanks be to God for his word. Amen. We're going to close with a wonderful hymn reminding us of the glorious truth of resurrection and life that we have because of the death and resurrection of Jesus, to whom be the glory forever. Amen.
Glory, glory.
Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son, endless is the victory thou'r death has won. Thank you that the grave clothes were left behind. Thank you for the witness of John and Peter and the first disciples. Thank you, loving Heavenly Father, that you promised the gift of your Holy Spirit and the gift of pastor teachers, that our faith may be secure. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you spent those days yet more teaching of the kingdom of God. And so we pray together that the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit may rest upon us this day and always. Amen.